So another foundering car. Wintry day again, so a little bit slippery road. The thing is, I was a little bit scared that something fell on my car, but this was only in a container. The thing is, in life, things are sometimes on the slippery road, but it depends, huh? For example, if you have all-wheel drive and good winter tires, you will find traction, and so it is always the case. Things can be hard, but you can also prepare yourself for something. Something is like a mindset, eh? For example, not every car has that all-wheel drive system, but for example the winter tires can be some of your preparation. And of course, when the snow doesn't fall, you don't need that winter tires, eh? Even if the temperature doesn't drop below 8 degrees, your normal tires will be better all the way. But if it does, it's good to have them. And it's also an entrepreneurship. If you prepare for the bad things and they don't arrive, okay, so be it. You prepared for something and now you did the work for nothing. So you wasted some of your energy. But when the winter does hit and you're not prepared, you will be in so much more trouble. Whereas if you're reaching winter, you are prepared and you can just manage. And of course it will not be easy all the way. It's not that you have enormous traction then, but you have a lot more traction than those that didn't prepare. Another thing that is of great importance in business is, even if you are on a slippery road, if you keep thinking, you can get out of there. So for example, what could be a slippery road? For example, the income has dropped and you still have to pay your debts. That's quite a slippery road, eh? Because nothing is coming in, or very little is coming in, and your debts are the same height as they everywhere. And if you're not able to pay them, they will take the things from you that they can. They will take everything of worth from you, because they want to recuperate their investment in you. And if you're not able to pay for it, they will pay for it themselves with your assets. And if you're left with nothing, it will be very hard to get up the steep hill again. Sometimes it's not even possible, eh? If a company has suffered so much, and also you have nothing to put in there anymore of yourself, you don't have your own reserves, then it's game over sometimes. But even in that situation, you should always be searching for attraction to get out of there. Because if you don't, of course you can be sad, of course you can be hurt, of course it cannot be righteous. But if you don't keep pushing, you will stay there or sink even deeper. So the only way forward is up. Don't go downward, always go upwards. And if you're not getting upward, but you're still sliding away, but you're trying the best as you can, you will not fall as deep as you would if you would not be trying. And if something doesn't work, don't be a tree. You can move, do something else, but keep trying. Of course, a waste of energy is nothing that you should be proud of, but not trying is even worse, in my opinion. And in this situation, you can, even in such a frustrating or depressing situation, you can take pride because you are working, you're trying to get out of this situation and move forward. It's very easy to roll over and say die. Some people never work. They just want to exploit the system and do it like that. Some people are, have a disability or something else and they cannot work, that's different, huh? But even then, I think if you have a disability but you still can get pride out of the work that you do for the society or what else, I think even if you have a disability, it's good to try to stay as active as possible for your mind, but also your body and your self-esteem. But some people, they don't, just don't care. They have no disability, but they just want to exploit the system and be there and let other people take care of them. Yeah, it's their choice, of course. But they also make a choice for those other people that do work, because they have to pay taxes, additional taxes, so that those other people can have their peace and their constant holidays. But so be it. Also in this system, you can say, okay, this is not fair, now I will not work anymore. But why? Why do you let other people dictate how you act? Just move forward. And if you move forward, you will still be paying taxes, of course. And it's still not a fair deal, of course. But you will be moving forward and you will be proud of what you achieve. That you will be able to care for your family. You will be able to build something, that you can say, okay, it's not much, but this is what I built and I'm proud of it. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. And perhaps that thing that you see as not much will grow into something very big because of your passion, because of your ideas, your hard work. And perhaps you can even share it with your family. You have sons and daughters and you say, okay, your daddy or your mother, they built something and now it's time that you are going to work. You can be part of that, part of the family business. There's also a very nice thing that you could give that to your children. And even before that, sometimes they need internships. You might be able to provide them because you have a company. It might be very small, but you have a company. You can get them in the system. If you have your employer, you can also ask him, I have a daughter, I have a son, perhaps they can do an internship here. Please help them out, and perhaps they will as well. But you have to ask. In your own company, you can make it happen. And that's a thing, a place of power that you come from, And they can also see how hard you are working to make everything happen. Because also for those children, it's very hard to have a concept of what work is if they have never worked. They are not exposed to the element of work, labor. But if they do get a taste of it, they will understand you better on a different level. And that's a good thing. It's a very good thing. And it's also, they don't have to do all the things like you do. They have new insights and that can also be beneficial to both of you. But you can show them how you done it all that time. And perhaps they have their new ideas, but also get a grip of this could be a way to start. But very often, you hear the snow cracking, Traction, you remember? No drama, just traction. Because you also remember that if you are not able to start and you want to get starting, get moving, go on that slope. And if you go like that, after a while, your own way, or your child does, that's great, but get going. Don't sink deeper. Have a great day, gents. So I was asked, this is another Founder in Car series, if you buy a car, what are the things that you're looking for? Well, I'm now driving a Tesla Model S, which is an electric car. For me, I have to be able to cross big distances, so I need to have a big amount of range. Electric range is the number one how do you say this, ball on the chain that is keeping the electric cars for functioning. And if you have to travel 200 plus kilometers a single trip, and you also have to come back the same day, they should have a car that under all circumstances can make that 450 kilometers bracket. And for example, if you have a car that can do 520, but that's on the perfect condition. Now we're driving in winter, and that will depreciate the amount of miles or kilometers that you can travel considerably. That's also very important, that you have a car that can make it. And there's another point that a lot of people don't take into consideration. Oftentimes that maximum range can be achieved only if you charge it to the maximum degree, so 100%, whereas it's better to charge it at 90%. And why is that? Because if you do that, you have a longer ability to of longer longevity of the batteries, and therefore you can enjoy the car far more than when you're only pushing it to the limit every time. So that's also a thing to take into consideration. And the last point is that not all of that 90% is usable. Normally also the car takes a limit, that you cannot deplete it completely, but you still have to use or keep some percentage, for example 5 or 10% for the car to function, so that it isn't depleted completely. Because also if you do that, you damage not only the battery, but also the car is completely unable to function. So there are some points to take into consideration, especially if you're buying an electric car. The other things is you should always, especially as a businessman, look at the incentives that there are. If there are incentives for a car, for example an electric car over a gasoline car, you can see if you can manage with the electric car to do the same thing that you can do with a gasoline car. Or some things are better, for example you have better silence, so it's better to have a conference call on the car and other conversations. But there are other things as well. If you cannot make the range, just forget about the electric car. Otherwise you have to plan in small breaks every time to keep the car charged. And also then you should look if there's a sufficient infrastructure on the route that you want to go. With Tesla this is really well done, especially in the Netherlands. I think it's one of the most charging structure of Tesla rich countries in the world. So that's a very good thing. And another thing you should take into consideration, can you make it? What does the car cost you, and is it a responsible thing to do? So you have a lot of cost. You have to pay the car, and that can be a direct payment, you can have a financial lease, but it is a financial obligation. But also the insurance is of importance, the cost of the road tax, other costs that are involved, for example maintenance. It's good to have a car, but it's very expensive to maintain, then you perhaps cannot keep it. And also other things, for me personally, I would, my minimum requirements are often that I want disc brakes all around, therefore have a good stopping power. I want a nice power to weight, that you also can get out of sticky situations and have a quicker reaction time. So a car, in my opinion, should have some reserves. It should be a safe car, because if you are an entrepreneur, you're a lot on the road, the biggest chance of you getting seriously hurt is very often in a car accident. And it should be functional. So if you have a car that's also functional for your family, that your family can be taken with it. And for example, I have now 5 seats in this car and 2 seats in the back if I have to take some of the friends of my children with me. But also the seats in the back, they were functional when they were young, but now it's a 5+2. Now that those kids are getting bigger and bigger, and also their friends are getting bigger and bigger, it's harder to seat them all. But that's of importance. And also, very important, the car should do something for you. It's a big investment, and if you then have something that makes you happy, that can solve a lot of those other issues that I mentioned. You just see it as something like a hobby. You see it's like something like a passion that's completely different than when you see it just as an A to B means of transportation. So I hope you like this video. Have a great day. Bye bye. In this Entrepreneur in Car, we will discuss what a company car might cost you also in the Netherlands. So a friend asked me, he said, this year is the last year that we have 12% that you have to pay for in private per year for electric cars. And the thing is, he said, then it could be a good deal. And he mentioned the Peugeot 3008 as an electric car, which would be 38,000 euros in the Netherlands. And then he said, yeah, that's a good deal now. And he says, I can easily pay that. But then also you have to calculate a little bit what it will cost you. Even if you have a company and you wanted to lease it, even if you have a company that makes a stable income, and even if it's just a financial lease instead of an operational lease, but with a financial lease you still have to pay back the money. So even if you have like 4.6% on your car of 38,000 euros, that will be every month over 700 euros that you have to pay back if you don't have a starting down payment, but just have a financial lease. And then as well you have to pay for the private use, the 12% per year. You will be taxed again for about 400 euros a month in addition. And that could be, depending on the tax bracket, it's the half of that. But also you have to pay for insurance, which can easily be 100 euro per month in addition. So then 700 and a bit, 200. Yeah? And for example, 200 for the private use and then 100 for insurance. It's already 1,000 euros. And then you have like, I think at least 50 euros a month on services, and then you have some additional things that you have to pay for example tire wear. So all in all it will be easily 1100 euros a month which it will cost you. And if you take that into consideration on a private track, this is a little bit different of course. If you have this, you can pay this to your company, you could put a little bit of that cost to the other side. For example, you could put the payments that you have to make for paying off the lease, you could put on the business side, and also you could put the payments that you have to do for the for the insurance also at the company side. So that could be halved then, and then it's 800 euros that can be halved, so it will be 400 euros then approximately. But also you have to think that you also have to pay for road tax in addition, and depending on the heavy car, now in the Netherlands it's road tax exempt, so you don't have to pay road tax at this moment for your electric car, but when you do, it's a heavy car. That should then put in addition again. So if you just look at the private side of the equation, if you can make enough money, because I also that I wanted to show you, how much money do you have to make in your company or to keep after all the expenses are paid, normal expenses, then there's also on the private side what it still costs you is that 400 euro. And in addition that another 300 euros in private, and that will be quite costly. I think it will easily set you back 650 to 700 euros a month in private cost. And that's something that not everyone is thinking about. And of course, I'm also a car guy. You can buy your car with your emotions and you can really enjoy it. But this lease that we calculated was also over a period of 5 years. Eh? So that's 60 installments of payments that you have to make. And if you don't make them, they can take the car away from you. So please take this into consideration. And if you don't have a car, but you still have to make payments and you are not able to work, for example, if you want to work and pay by working for the payments that you have to make on your car, you will be in big trouble. Have a great day. So we're driving now to this winterland in the Netherlands. And it brings me to a quote, "Winter is coming." This is a quote that has a universal appeal, but also has been made famous by a series called Game of Thrones, which I haven't watched. But I heard there were three principles. One is there was a tribe that always prepared for the worst. Therefore, I prepare for the winter. Winter is coming. Two, the tribe also installed fear in the hearts of their enemies because they were so associated with that winter is coming that they also were associated with the winter. So if they would strike their enemy, it would be them coming for them. And three, the other one was that there was a certain a group within that tribe, the whites, that also could return. But more important for us as an entrepreneur, a founder, you need to prepare for the worst. And also now, with this COVID-19 corona crisis, you can imagine that there will be a winter coming, and not like this, that the weather will change, but that the winter will come for all of us, and not only the entrepreneurs, but also those that are employees, because this COVID corona thing, crisis as they call it, has also a huge impact on the economic system and will give a big crisis in the future. It already gave a big crisis, but most people cannot see this. It's like a big block of ice, only a part is above the water and most is below it. And why can't we see it? Because governments, etc., still keep things going, especially in the westernized countries, which results in they bring in subsidies and other arrangements, but those subsidies are not free money. The subsidies are paid for by the people of a country, especially the taxpayers. And why so? Well, if you, for example, print additional money, this means that all other money will devaluate. If you print 10% more money, all the other money will devaluate almost 10%. So that gives you a little bit of insight of what is happening. The other thing is that when you reach out and you give people money, the government, for example, takes on a bigger a bigger debt, and that debt has to be paid by the government, you think? Yes, but the government will pay it with money from their people. So the money has been paid by those that pay taxes and will be paid in the future as well. That being said, those are all just economic constructs, but also if the economy is collapsing, another economy will take over. And once that other economy takes over, you will be set back even further. So I don't want to be pessimistic, because that's not my thing. I just waved to my mother. She was there And it's not just an economic thing, and I don't want to be pessimistic, and we don't need to be pessimistic, because also after winter will always be a spring, but it could be that the winter takes a big toll, because those that cannot make it will be set back years in their development, their freedom also from being a slave to the system, because the system will keep you in slavery, that you just have to have that 9-to-5 grind, or even more. If you look at the United States, for example, it's very common that people will keep working until they die. Also, it's very common that in some states, because the cost of living are that extremely high, it's very normal that you have 2 jobs or even 3 jobs to facilitate that you can pay the rent and some other things. So it's not just living and enjoying, but it pays the necessities so that you keep on producing again, to work in a system, and it maintains you to work in the system. The system has some benefits, because there is a system, let's be clear. Without a system it would be even harder. But you can also make your own system, and by doing so you are a lot less vulnerable to the normal slavery that the system embodies. But the system is directed at producing as much as possible and getting the most possible leverage out of the cattle, so to say. And in this case, the cattle is including humans, because they just keep them in the system, and by keeping them in the system they will produce, and they can be taxed as well. It's not that you should not work with the system, I think you should, but you should also have your own plan. And if you're not wanting to be a 9-to-5 slave all the time, and you want to escape this rat race, there are some options that you could consider. And one of those options is that you have a plan. And if you have a plan, you can also make some money without putting hours in, but just make money for, yeah, that you have something, an asset that produces some money. It could be stocks, could be real estate, could be all kinds of things, of course. But that would help tremendously. Or you could, as an entrepreneur, you have your own ID, and you don't have to only put in hours for the production, but also the ID itself produces something for you. So then you have a little bit less relationship between input of hours and output of income. And those things, even in winter, like it is now, you could consider. And I'm not saying that you have to do it at this time, because many of us are just scraping by, and then that's it, just scrape by. But the winter, in this sense, also when the economy will be going down, can also trigger something in yourself that you think, okay, I understand this now, I wasn't prepared as I should have been, but I will prepare when the situations will change again in my favor. That's also a good lesson, I must say that everyone has to learn his lessons, and it is never too late. But the earlier you learn your lessons, the more you have your cumulative gain, so to say. So for example, if you have an asset that produces something for you and you don't need that, you can also reinvest that into new assets that can produce for you. And that's a good thing, if it's possible. For many people it's not possible, myself included. I don't always have the things that I want to have in place to produce something. But you can think about it, and when you do think about it, you can make it more of a reality. But you should not only think about it, but also do it. Even if it's a small thing, start doing it. Okay, we're home. Have a great day.